ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय। ओम
ओम
नमो भगवते
वासुदेवाय।
वासुदेवाय। नारायण नमस्कृत्य नरोत्तमं देवीं सरस्वती
सरस्वतीं व्यासं ततो जयमुदीरयेत्। शृण्वतं स्वकथा कृष्ण पुण्यश्रवणकीर्तना हृदय अनन्तस्थो हे अभद्राणि विदुनुतेषु नित्यं भागवत सेवया भागवते उत्तमश्लोके भक्तिर्भवति नास्तिके।
कृष्णाय वासुदेवाय देवकी नंदनाय च नंदगोपाकुमाराय गोविंदाय नमो नमः। मूकं करोति वाचालं अंगं लंगायते गिरिं यत्कृपातमहं वंदे श्रीगुरुं दीनतारिणं। हरे कृष्ण डिवोटीज, वेलकम टू अवर श्रीमद् भागवतम सेशन टुडे। सो फार वी कवर्ड, we are currently studying third chapter. We covered two full chapters and we covered up to around 34th verse of third chapter. So in what so far we covered, so the first chapter begins, what was the context of first, what was the primary subject discussed in the first chapter? Anybody?
Question by sages.
Questions.
The six questions by the sages. Yeah. So first, after obeisance, after offering the obeisances to Lord Sri Krishna, the author of Srimad Bhagavatam, Vyasadeva, brings about the context, which is the six questions asked by the sages of Naimisharanya to Suta Goswami. What are the six questions? Anybody remembers?
What is the ultimate good for all living beings?
What is the ultimate good for all living beings? What is the essence of all the scriptures? Those are the two questions which are answered in the second chapter. Bhakti is the essence of all the scriptures. Bhagavan Sri Krishna is the one to be worshipped. So those two are the first questions. And then third question.
What is the purpose of appearance of Lord Krishna as
the son of? What is the purpose of appearance of Lord Krishna as the son of?
Vasudeva.
Yeah. So the purpose of appearance of Lord Sri Krishna. And then?
Purushavataras and
Leelavataras.
Leelavataras was asked. And then Purushavataras. And then finally?
Finally.
Where the shelter, where the Lord takes the shelter after the Krishna's disciples.
Yeah. After the disappearance of Lord Sri Krishna, where did Dharma took shelter of? So that was the question. So these are the six questions asked by the sages of Naimisharanya. So this chapter 2 begins with answering these questions. Chapter 2, first, Suta Goswami praises the questions because they are going to cause Lokamangalam. They are beneficial for everybody because the topic of the questions is
Krishna,
Sri Krishna. So the topics related to Krishna are beneficial for everybody. So it's Lokamangalam. So that was praised by Suta Goswami. And then he starts answering the questions. First by talking about bhakti as the most essential process for achieving Krishna. Krishna is the ultimate goal. So those two concepts were discussed, answered. And then he describes about the process of bhakti in detail, with the stages of bhakti, if you remember. And before the stages of bhakti, one more concept was discussed, which is whatever actions we do, the ultimate purpose of that is to please Vasudeva, right? Otherwise, any effort we do is Shamaya Vahike Avala, right? So all the actions that we perform in this human life must be directed to please the Vasudeva. It should develop the taste for hearing the pastimes of Vasudeva. And then there is the stages of devotion, beginning with satam kripa, and then mahat seva, and then ultimately after bhava and prema stages, one gets to see the form of the Lord. So those are the stages of bhakti that were discussed. After that, we move on to the incarnations, Purusha incarnations. The whole purpose of Purusha incarnations is to reclaim the conditions jivas who are stuck in the material existence. There is a brief description of Purusha, the first Purusha avatara, which is
Karana Dakshaya Mahavishnu.
Mahavishnu, who is the cause of all the universes, and within each universe again there is the same Mahavishnu expands into
Garbhadakshaya,
and then into each living entity Lord expands into the form known as
Kshirodakshaya Vishnu.
And from Kshirodakshaya Vishnu, all the
incarnations
into the material existence come through his media, via medium. And then there is description of, in the third chapter we saw the descriptions of all the various incarnations in the recent past, right? About 22 incarnations, primarily Leela and Guna, and some Sakta Vesha avatars are also discussed, right? Like Buddha, Parashurama, they were also discussed in brief, like what are all the incarnations. And then at the end of the description of all the incarnations, there is mention of Lord Sri Krishna as the source of all the incarnations. He's not just an incarnation, he's also the source of all the incarnations, right? After that, after describing the Purusha avatars, Leela avatars, and other types of important incarnations, and describing the incarnation of Lord Sri Krishna, the source of all the incarnations, then what about the material existence? How do people who do not have spiritual vision understand God behind all this? So to that understanding, the Virat Purusha incarnation was described. Just like this physical body with the gross physical body and the subtle mind exists, there is also this Virat form of the existence within the universe. Right? The whole universe one can conceive as the form of the Lord. Just like for the physical body, like we have, the body we see, the physical appearance and the subtle body that we have is not the real person who we are, right? Similarly, when we see this gigantic universal existence, which is in an orderly fashion functioning, while we can take that as the the form of the Lord, behind the Virat Purusha also there is the form, the real Supreme Lord, who is Adokshita, who is spiritual, the spiritual form of the Lord that exists beyond him. So that is how, just like we can understand the soul is the real essence, soul is the real person we are, beyond this gross physical Virat form of the Lord, there is the actual form of the Lord, the transcendental form of the Lord. So just like we can understand soul in relation to the physical body, we can understand that there is the supreme transcendental form of the Lord, which is beyond the physical existence that we see all around. So that is how we can understand there is actually a form of Lord, just like we can understand there is soul within the body. So that is the purpose of Virat Purusha description. The Virat Purusha is just to help people who cannot understand the transcendental glories of the Lord. So that's where we stopped last week. Now let's continue the discussion of third chapter, chapter 4. So we covered 34. Yeah. So I'll just read the translation of 34, which we already covered. If the illusory energy subsides and the living entity becomes fully enriched with knowledge by the grace of the Lord, then he becomes at once enlightened with self-realization, thus becomes situated in his own glory. So this is after describing the Virat form of the Lord, right? So the previous translation says, whenever a person experiences by self-realization that both the gross and subtle bodies have nothing to do with the pure self, at that time he sees himself as well as the Lord, right? So similarly, a person can go beyond Virat form to actually to the transcendental form of the Lord. Let's start with 35th verse. Evam janmani karmani.
Evam janmani karmani.
Hiyakurtur ajanasya cha.
Hiyakurtur ajanasya cha.
Varnayanti smas. Kavayo
Varnayanti sma kavayo
Veda guhyani hrutpate
Veda guhyani hrutpate.
Yeah, please read, anyone.
Thus learned men describe the births and activities of the unborn and inactive, which is undiscoverable even in the Vedic literatures. He is the Lord of the heart.
Thus the learned man describe the births and activities of the unborn and inactive, which is undiscoverable even in the Vedic literatures. He is the Lord of the heart, right? Yeah, so even the Vedic knowledge does not, so the personality of Godhead is not easily found in the Vedic descriptions, because most of the Vedic descriptions are filled with descriptions of demigods, and so one may get lost while studying Vedas about the personality of Godhead. So that's why he's called Veda Guhyani Hritpate, the Lord of the heart, right? But great people actually describe birth and activities of the unborn and inactive, right? Why do they describe? Just by hearing the pastimes of the Lord, of his appearance and activities, what happens? We studied in Bhagavad Gita about this, right? Janma karma chame divyam evam yo veti tattvataha tyaktva deham punar janma naiti mameti swarjana, right? So one who understands the appearances of the and the activities of the Supreme Lord doesn't have to take another birth in the material existence. So that's why learned men describe the births and activities of the unborn and inactive, which is undiscoverable even in the Vedic. If you study Vedic scriptures to understand Lord, you may not get the understand. But the great devotees, you see, like great devotees, for example, in the past, so many great devotees, they only describe about the activities of the Lord. Because that is the essence, and that is missed in the Vedic scriptures in large. He is the Lord of the heart. Both the Lord and the living entities are essential, all spiritual, therefore both of them are eternal, and neither of them has birth and death. The difference is that the so-called births and disappearances of the Lord are unlike those of the living beings. Right? Lord also appears like anybody in the material world, but he is different. The living beings who take birth and then again accept death are bound by the laws of material nature. But the so-called appearance and disappearance of the Lord are not actions of material nature, but are demonstrations of his internal potency. Lord appears by his internal potency. We appear forced by the external potency. Right? We appear forced by our karma. So this we already discussed. So that is the difference between Lord's appearance and our appearance. They're quite different. One is by internal potency, the other is by external energy. Sava idam visva mamogalila.
Sava idam visvam amogha leela.
Srijati avyati attina sajjate smin.
Srijati avyati attina sajjate smin.
Bhuteshu chanta hita atma tantra. Sadvargikam jigrate sadgunesha.
Sadvargam jigrate sadgunesha.
Now, some descriptions of the Lord's qualities are given further, just to differentiate between ordinary living entities, right? Amogha Leela. His activities are spotless. Lord's, you know, activities are spotless. You know, you cannot find anything wrong in that, right? And they are not affected by material modes. Nasajjate means they are not affected by material modes. And then other qualities are sadvargikam. Sadvargikam means, and all these activities of Lord are, you know, endowed with all the potencies of the Supreme, you know, the opulences, six opulences of the Supreme. Lord's activities are filled with, you know, potencies of his opulences. Sadguna Esha is the master of the six senses. So these are the some of the qualitative differences of the Supreme Lord. Please read the translation.
The Lord, whose activities are always spotless, is the master of six senses and is fully omnipotent with six opulences. He creates the manifested universes and maintains them and annihilates them without being in the least affected. He is within every living being and is always independent.
Mm. So he creates the manifested universe, maintains them, and annihilates them without being in the least affected. Right? So to create the various universes, Lord interacts with his own energy, which is the external energy, Bahiranga Shakti, but he is not affected. He is within every living being and is always independent. He is within every living entity that exists. He is there, but he is always independent. In comparison, look at us, right? For example, we see a mango fruit. What happens? There is some reaction within us, correct? To eat that. So we are affected, right? Whenever matra sparshastu kaunte, right? Matra, tanmatras. Whenever the jiva comes in contact with sense object, there is a chain reaction within the jiva, right? It comes under the influence of the modes, right? We see a nice car, we might feel like having that car. Or we see a nice house, we might feel like having that house or similar house. So that is the action of the modes. While Lord appears like every other living entity in the material world, Lord is distinguished from the jivas because he stays independent, unaffected by the modes. So that is the point clearly called out here. He performs Amogha Leela, the most spotless pastimes. He creates all the universe. He interacts with all the jivas. He exists within every jiva. There is so much chance that he can be affected by the, the modes, right? He closely interacts. He actually perceives before the conditioned jiva perceives anything. But he stays independent and unaffected. So that is his qualitative difference. Here he is called Amogha Leela, which indicates that there is nothing lamentable in his creation. Right? So there is nothing lamentable in his creation. Everything is perfectly created. Right? Why we experience lamentation in the material world? Because of the misunderstanding. Because of the misunderstanding of the purpose of our existence. Right? the creation is created for one purpose, that is to help us deliver from the material existence. If you don't understand that aspect, then we may undergo lamentation because our expectations are wrong. To the purpose, to the actual purpose of, right, if we understand the actual purpose of creation and live our life according to that, then there is no, there is nothing to lament in the material existence. It is perfectly, you know, orchestrated for that purpose. Those who create disturbance in his creation are themselves disturbed. We see all the time that happen. He creates these manifested universes in order to reclaim the living beings who are within them, suffering threefold miseries, maintains them, and in due course annihilates them without being the least affected by such actions. This is what happens. He is not affected. He is beyond that. न चास्य कश्चिन् निपुणेन धातुर्
न चास्य कश्चिन् निपुणेन धातुः
अवैति जन्तु कुमनीष ऊते
रवैति जन्तु कुमनीष ऊते
नामानि रूपानि मनोवचोभि
नामानि रूपानि मनोवचोभि
It's important to read these verses like this. Okay, all of you should try to participate. Yeah, please read the translation.
The foolish with a poor fund of knowledge cannot know the transcendental nature of the forms, names, and activities of the Lord, who is playing like an actor in a drama. Nor can they express such things, neither in the speculation nor in their words.
Mm. So there are people who cannot understand the form and activities of the Lord, right? So they cannot know the transcendental nature of the forms, names, and activities of the Lord, right? Because of their unfortunate situation. Lord is playing like an actor in a drama. Right, so he comes to the material world and he enacts various activities which are all transcendental, and a foolish person cannot understand because of his poor fund of knowledge, right? Nor can they express such things, neither in their speculations nor in their words. Those people cannot understand how Lord can, you know, come to the material world and exhibit various pastimes, and what is the purpose behind the existence, you know, the activities of the Lord. They cannot understand. For example, if you don't know Bharatanatyam, okay, you went there and you are watching Bharatanatyam, right? You don't understand why people are dancing like this, you know, why they are making those steps. You may, you know, there is some experience for the eyes, but you don't deeply appreciate if you don't know the subject, right? But if you understand, hey, this form of dance is actually a praise of the Lord, Lord's activities, Lord's pastimes, and you know, they're trying to express through these emotions and, you know, the various steps, right? One who doesn't know the subject and the intent behind the particular performance, they cannot understand, in any greater detail about the, you know, the particular form of dance. So similarly, Lord is coming to this world and is performing various activities, and, you know, with his loving devotees, performing, you know, so many transcendental activities which we cannot understand, or, you know, a person who is with poor fund of knowledge cannot understand. Just like one cannot appreciate and understand any activity that he doesn't know, right? Who doesn't know the intent behind that. Yeah. So basically, it's an expression of so the author is expressing concern for the unfortunate souls here. this way. The materialistic people. So Prabhupada talks about the two classes of materialistic people here. There are, please read anybody here to here.
There are two classes of materialists, namely the fruitative workers and the empiric philosophers. The fruitative workers have practically no information of the absolute truth. And the mental speculators, after being frustrated in fruitative activities, turn their faces towards the absolute truth and try to know him by mental speculation. And for all these men, the absolute truth is a mystery, as the jugglery of the magician is a mystery to children. Being deceived by the jugglery of the Supreme Being, the non-devotees who may be very dexterous in fruitative work and mental speculation are always in ignorance. With such limited knowledge, they are unable to penetrate into the mysterious region of transcendence.
Yeah. So this point is primarily highlighting that frustration with fruitive activities is not just the qualification to understand the personality of Godhead. They are frustrated, but unless they take shelter of a devotee of the Lord, unless the mercy of the devotee comes into his life, even people who are, any of these materialistic people, either fruity workers or empiric philosophers, they cannot understand, or they cannot enter the devotional life. It still remains mystery and, for their entire life. So this section is subsequent to Virat Purusha incarnation. Virat Purusha was described, and now there is some description of how the various jivas who are lost, who cannot understand this form of the Lord, right? The transcendental form of the Lord is described here. Saveda dhatu padavim parasya.
भजेत
तत्पाद सरोज गंधम So this is a very beautiful verse. Ratangapani. Ratangapani means this is one of the first description of Lord Krishna, one who bears in his hand the wheel of a chariot, for his devotee's sake. He is doing that, correct? Yeah, let's read the translation. Yeah. Please read.
Only those who render unreserved, uninterrupted, favorable service unto the lotus feet of Lord Krishna, who carries the wheel of chariot in his hand, can know the creator of the universe, power and transcendence.
So here the description is about a person who can understand Lord in his full glory. Three qualities mentioned. So what are the two qualities? Amayaya. Amaya means without reservation, means without any other consideration, without having any other self-interest. Satantayanu vritya. Satantaya means without any gap. Means continuously, right? Without any gap, unceasing. Right? Anuvritya. Anuvritya means favorably. Anu means to favor, right? Favorably. Bhajeta means render a service to his lotus feet. Tatpada. Sarojagandham, which is fring, which has the fragrance of the lotus. Bhajeta tatpada sarojagandham. Dhuranta virus of the very great, of the greatly powerful. Ratangapani. Means of the Lord Krishna, who bears in his hand the wheel of a chariot. So who can achieve the favor of the Supreme Lord and understanding of the Supreme Lord? One who without any reservations, first one, amayaya, satantaya, without any gap, unceasing, unstopped, continuous, anuvrittya, favorably. One who continuously and favorably, without any other reservation, performs bhajate, bhajeta tatpada, renders devotion service to his lotus feet. So such person will be endowed with the understanding of the Supreme Lord. So such a beautiful verse, right? Only those who render unreserved, uninterrupted, favorable service unto the Supreme Lord, so unto the lotus feet of the Supreme Lord Krishna, who carries the wheel of the chariot in his hand, can know the creator of the universe in his full glory, power, and transcendence. So this is a glorification of bhakti process. Please read this.
Everyone within the creation of the Lord is rendering service to the Lord indirectly or directly. No one is an exception to this law of the Lord. Those who are rendering service indirectly, being forced by the illusory agent of the Lord, are rendering service unto him.
One second.
Sorry. Yeah, illusory agent of the Lord are rendering service unto him unfavorably. But those who are rendering service unto him directly under the direction of his beloved agent are rendering service unto him favorably. Such favorable servitors are devotees of the Lord, and by the grace of the Lord, they can enter into the mysterious region of transcendence by the mercy of the Lord. But the mental speculators remain in darkness all the time. As stated in Bhagavad Gita, the Lord himself guides the pure devotees toward the path of realization due to their constant engagement in the loving service of the Lord in spontaneous affection. That is the secret of entering into the kingdom of God. Fruitive activities and speculation are no qualifications for entering.
So as stated in 10th chapter, Lord gives the guidance for the devotee from within the heart. Lord himself guides all the pure devotees towards the path of liberation due to the constant engagement in the loving service. So all we need to do is, you know, develop the taste for hearing, chanting, and, you know, continue performing devotional service. This is the secret of entering into the kingdom of God. Fruitive activities and speculation are no qualification. अतेहधन्य भगवंत इत्थम्
अतेहधन्य भगवंत इत्थम्
यद्वासुदेवे अखिल लोकनाथे
यद्वासुदेवे अखिल लोकनाथे
कुर्वन्ति सर्वात्मकमात्म भावम्
कुर्वन्ति सर्वात्मकमात्म भावम्
नयत्र भूया परिवर्त उग्रा
नयत्र भूया परिवर्त उग्रा
Please read.
Only by making such inquiries in this world can one be successful and perfectly cognizant. For such inquiries invokes transcendental ecstatic love unto the personality of Lord Godhead, who is the proprietor of all the universes and guarantee 100% immunity from the dreadful repetition of birth and death.
Inquiries into the personality of Godhead are praised here because they invoke transcendental ecstatic love. Right? So when one understands how Lord is, you know, one understands Lord's qualities, how he is supremely loving, supremely benevolent, you know, how he created all these universes for our purpose, right? So then that invokes love for him within the heart of the conditioned soul. And so that will actually help us, you know, become immune to dreadful repetition of birth and death. So one should make such inquiries, spiritual inquiries. Ateha Danya. Who is successful in the material world? Akhila Lokanada. Akhila Lokanada means all embracing unto the proprietor of the universes, Lokanada, Supreme God. So the inquiries of the sages headed by Saunaka are herewith praised by Sutta Goswami on the merit of their transcendental nature. Right? As already concluded, only the devotees of the Lord can know him to a considerable extent. No one else can know him at all. So the devotees are perfectly cognizant of spiritual knowledge. The personality of Godhead is the last word in absolute truth. Impersonal Brahman and localized Paramatma are included in the knowledge of the personality of Godhead. So one who knows the personality of Godhead can automatically know all about him. Yeah. So inquiries of the Saunaka Rishis were praised by the Lord, they were praised in this literature. Idam Bhagavatam. इदं भागवतं नाम पुराणं ब्रह्म संहिता
इदं भागवतं नाम पुराणं
ब्रह्म संहिता
उत्तम श्लोक चरितं चकार भगवान ऋषिः
उत्तम श्लोक चरितं चकार भगवान ऋषिः
निश्रेयस साय लोकस्य धन्यं स्वस्ति आयनं महत्
This Srimad Bhagavatam is the literary incarnation of God, and it is compiled by Srila Vyasadeva, the incarnation of God. It is meant for the ultimate good of all people, and it is all successful, all blissful, and all perfect.
Mm. Now the literature is praised. Srimad Bhagavatam is the literary incarnation of God, right? Because it appeared after Lord Krishna left this world. So Srimad Bhagavatam is the shelter for all the religion. Right? So it's the literary incarnation, and it is compiled by Srila Vyasadeva, the incarnation of God. It is meant for the ultimate good of all people. Right? So this is an answer to the first question again. Right? What is the real ultimate good for all people? And it is all successful, all blissful, and all perfect. Dhanyam swasti ayanam mahat. All blissful and all perfect. Swasti ayanam means all blissful, all perfect. Because this is describing primarily Brahma Samhitam, the incarnation of Lord Krishna, and described by whom? Uttama Shloka means the Supreme Lord. Described by Bhagavan, the incarnation of the personality of Godhead. Bhagavan Rishi means the incarnation of Godhead, who is Sri Vyasadeva. And the purpose is Nishreya Saya, for the ultimate good, Lokasya, of all people, Dhanyam, fully successful. Okay? So there is no other literature which comes in comparison to Bhagavatam. It is compiled by the incarnation of the Lord and describes Brahma Samhitam, which is the Uttama Shloka. It describes the pastimes of the Supreme Lord, Uttama Shloka, and his acharitam activities. And so it is meant for the ultimate good of all people. And we all know studying Bhagavatam, reading Bhagavatam is so blissful, right? While we are reading shlokas, we can feel that, right? The verses, the words are so sweet to just speak. That's why it's mentioned as all successful, all blissful, and all perfect. Swasti ayanam mahat. Dhanyam swasti ayanam mahat. This is glorification of Srimad Bhagavatam. The section, last five verses are glorification of Srimad Bhagavatam. Yeah. Please read.
Lord Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu declared that Srimad Bhagavatam is the spotless sound representation of all Vedic knowledge and history. There are selected histories of great devotees who are in direct contact with the personality of Godhead. Srimad Bhagavatam is the literary incarnation of Lord Sri Krishna and is therefore non-different from him. Srimad Bhagavatam should be worshipped as respectfully as we worship the Lord. Thereby, we can derive the ultimate blessings of the Lord through its careful and patient study. As God is all light, all bliss, and all perfection, so also is Srimad Bhagavatam.
Srimad Bhagavatam should be worshipped as respectfully as we worship the Lord. It should be treated as such, just like Lord Krishna himself. There is no difference. That's how one should approach Srimad Bhagavatam. Therefore, we can derive the ultimate blessings of the Lord through its careful and patient study. Right? Careful and patient study. That's exactly what we are doing. We are not rushing. We are going through every verse, trying to assimilate, you know, trying to appreciate the meaning and trying to apply in our own life. So this is important. Right? We should go carefully and patiently study Bhagavad. As God is all light, all bliss, and all perfection, so also is Srimad Bhagavatam. So Srimad Bhagavatam is equivalent to Lord himself, directly. It's a perfect literature. And what does it have? Selected histories of great devotees who are in direct contact with the Supreme Lord. All the pastimes of the Lords that we do, that we hear from Srimad Bhagavatam are where like great personalities like Prahlad Maharaj, Dhruva Maharaj, where they have direct, or Narada Muni, they all have direct interaction with the Lord. So that is going to give us a lot of inspiration and, you know, the direction for us. We can have all the transcendental light of Supreme Brahman, Sri Krishna, from the recitation of Srimad Bhagavatam, provided it is received through the medium of the transparent spiritual master. Lord Chaitanya's private secretary, Srila Swarup Damodar Goswami, advised all intending visitors who came to see the Lord at Puri to make a study of the Bhagavatam from the person Bhagavatam. Person Bhagavatam is the self-realized bona fide spiritual master, and through him only can one understand the lesson of Bhagavatam in order to receive the desired result. For example, we study the purports of Srila Prabhupada directly. We don't try to, you know, give our own interpretation and meaning for this. Right? So that is hearing in parampara. One can derive from the study of Bhagavatam all the benefits that are possible to be derived from the personal presence of the Lord. See, it's equivalent to personal presence of the Lord. That's why it is recommended every day one should read at least a verse of Srimad Bhagavatam. It carries with it all the transcendental blessings of Lord Sri Krishna that we can expect from his personal contact. Right? So one can receive the blessings of the Lord just by reading Srimad Bhagavatam every day. These are all glories of Srimad Bhagavatam, his last 3-4 verses.
तदिदं ग्राह्यामि आशा
Saram Saram Samudratam.
So what does Srimad Bhagavatam has? Right? What does this book have? So that is described in this. Please read the translation.
Sri Vyasadeva delivered it to his son, who is the most respected among the self-realized, after extracting the cream of all Vedic literatures and histories of the universe.
Who compiled this? Vyasdeva himself compiled this, right? And whom did he give after he compiled? He compiled and gave it to his son, Srila Sukadeva Goswami. And he is the most respected among the self-realized, right? Because he is the most renounced person, right? Just by after birth itself, we will read the history of Srimad Bhagavatam in the next chapter. It's a very nice story to hear. How right after his birth, he just leaves his father, Vyasadeva, and wants to run away from the home to basically worship the Supreme Lord. So he doesn't want to be attached and stay at home. So that is the nature of his soul. He's so renounced, he doesn't even wear clothes. So that is his nature. And what is this? Saram Saram Samudhyatam. This Bhagavatam is, of all the Vedic literature, this is like the summary of all the best pieces put together, given at the end. Right? It's like cream of all the Vedic literature. Right? Saram Samaram Samudhritam. After extracting the cream of all the Vedic literatures and histories of the universe. So this book is compilation of all of them, the best of all the pieces in the Vedic literature. Please read this.
All the stories mentioned in the Puranas and Mahabharata, etc., are actual histories, not only of this planet, but also of millions of other planets within the universe. Sometimes the history of planets beyond this world appears to such men to be unbelievable, but they do not know that different planets are not equal in all respects, and that therefore some of the historical facts derived from other planets do not correspond with the experience of this planet.
There are descriptions within Srimad Bhagavatam about Jambudvipa and so many other places which appear very, because they are not something that we can relate in our own personal experience within the material, within the world that we live. They're very fascinating and very mystical. And some of the people cannot believe such things. So Prabhupada was talking about that. But in the essence is that this is the essence of all the scriptures, the histories. It says histories, right? It doesn't say itihasam. Itihasanam means this is a compilation of history. It's not compilation of some mental speculations or ideas. Why would Vyasadeva spend all his time writing these 18,000 verses talking about some imaginary or speculative stories? This is actually a real history that has happened in the various planetary systems, in the various ages, right? For example, in the next chapter, we read the history of the appearance of Narada Muni and how. It's about description of how Narada Muni came to Krishna consciousness, how he became a devotee. Right? So in his past life, how he was the history was of another day of Brahma. Right? We are in the current day of Brahma. Right? So this past time Vyasadeva writing happened, before the Kali Yuga began, which is this particular day. But before this day, on another day of Brahma, how Narada Muni, right, became a devotee, that was described. So in this way, the histories were described, from various kalpas and various, cycles of, the universal existence, all compiled to give the best experience that one can. The essence of all the scriptures, the essence of all that you need to know is given, put together in Srimad Bhagavatam. Saram Saram Samudritam. The most essential principles are put together in one book, that is Srimad Bhagavatam. It's equivalent to Lord Krishna. It should be taken with that much respect. The great rishis like Vyasadeva has no business putting some imaginary stories in their literature. Yeah, please read this also.
the great rishis like Vyasa had no business putting some imaginary stories in their literatures. Vyasadeva is a great authority in the subject matter of Srimad Bhagavatam. Being so important, he delivered the message first to his great son Srila Sukadeva Goswami. It is compared to the cream of the milk. Vedic literature is like the milk ocean of knowledge. Cream or butter is the most palatable essence of milk, and so also is Srimad Bhagavatam, for it contains all palatable, instructive, and authentic versions of different activities of the Lord and his devotees.
Yeah. At the same time, this is a caution given here.
Milk is undoubtedly very good and nourishing, but when it is touched by the mouth of a snake, it is no longer nourishing. Rather, it becomes a source of death. Similarly, those who are not strictly in the Vaishnava discipline should not make a business of this Bhagavatam and become a cause of spiritual death for so many hearers.
If one should not hear from people who are not devotees, who are not in parampara. Satu samsravayam asha.
Satu samshravayam asha.
Maharajam parikshitam. Prayopavistam gangayam.
Paritam paramarshibhi.
Now the parampara is described. Now Vyasadeva gave it to his son, Sudeva Goswami. And how this parampara went ahead after that. Yeah, please read.
Sukadeva Goswami, the son of Vyasadeva, in his turn delivered the Bhagavatam to the great emperor Parikshit, who sat surrounded by sages on the bank of the Ganges, awaiting death without taking food or drink.
Sukadeva Goswami, the son of Vyasadeva, in his turn delivered this Bhagavatam. He heard from his father, and now he delivered this to great emperor Parikshit, who sat surrounded with sages on the bank of Ganges, awaiting death without taking food or drink. It's very important, the principle mentioned here. So here, the qualities of hearer is mentioned. Vyasadeva, Sukadeva Goswami, who is first of all fully renounced. You know, he gave up his family right after his birth. Fully renounced, doesn't even wear clothes. Now this great renunciate was the speaker of Bhagavatam. And who was hearing? Parikshit Maharaj, who was a great emperor. But he is hearing at a time when his death is approaching fast approaching death. So he now gave up eating food, drinking water, or he's just avoiding death. And he has no other business, no other thought, fully focused just on the message of Bhagavatam. So it's a great combination of a great renunciant speaker and a great renunciant hearer. So in this combination, great combination, there were the most important questions asked, and the best answers for them were given. So in this the whole conversation was basically a great combination of the best people, the best combination of hearer, the best and also the speaker. So the message is going to be extremely powerful, because there is no other business, there is no kama vasana or any other in this whole conversation, because the hearer, the Parikshit Maharaj, has no other interest. He's just awaiting his death without taking any food or drink. So, Praya Upavishtam, who sat until death without food or drink. So that is the nature of the hearer in this case. So his utmost, he's hearing with utmost attention to every word spoken by Sukadeva Goswami. So it's a great conversation. Can you read this?
Srimad Bhagavatam was heard by Emperor Parikshit as it was recited by the able Sukhdev Goswami. And both the speaker and the receiver of the messages of Bhagavatam were duly delivered by the same medium.
So Bhagavatam is the most prized thing here. Sukhdev Goswami was a great speaker. And Parikshit Maharaj was a great hearer, receiver of the message of Bhagavatam. Both were benefited by just speaking and hearing Bhagavatam. Both were delivered by the same medium, Bhagavatam. It always benefits the speaker as well as the receiver. Now, this is the answer. So, one question is now answered. Krishneswa dhamo pagate. Dharma jnana dibhi saha.
Kalau nashta drisham esha.
Puranarko dhunodita. This is a very important verse. You should memorize this. Yeah, please read.
This Bhagavat Purana is a brilliant as the sun, and it has arisen just after the departure of Lord Krishna to his own abode, accompanied by religion, knowledge, etc. Persons who have lost their vision due to the dense darkness of ignorance in the age of Kali shall get light from this Purana.
So the importance of this Purana, what more can be a description greater than this? Right? So this is, Bhagavad Purana is brilliant like sun. Dharma jnana divisaha. It's a brilliant knowledge put together. Right? And what is the purpose of this? Kalavunasto drisham nesha. In Kali Yuga, people lost direction, vision. Right? Persons who have lost their vision due to the dense darkness of ignorance in the age of Kali. In the Kali Yuga, people have no interest at all in spiritual life. Right? They have no inquiries about path of perfection. For such people, this Purana, the best of all Puranas, which is like brilliant like sun, dhunoditaha, it has arisen. Just like sun has arisen, when sun rises, what happens? All the darkness in the world is dispelled. So similarly, Lord Krishna descended, Srimad Bhagavatam ascended, just like sun. Such a dramatic description is given here, right? Just as soon as Lord went with all the religion, when Lord goes, everything is literally gone, right? But just like sun arises, Srimad Bhagavatam rose like sun. And now giving direction and light and meaning and purpose for all the people who have taken birth after that. Kalau nasta drisham nesha puranarko dhunoditaha. So for all people who have lost direction because of being born in Kali Yuga, especially, Srimad Bhagavatam is the only hope. It has risen just like brilliant sun. Just like sun dispels all darkness, Bhagavatam dispels all misgivings of the understanding of Supreme Law. Right? Clearly establishes the purpose of life. It's a very nice. Prabhupada describes the purpose of Srimad Bhagavatam. Can anybody read?
Except for God, no one can establish the principles of religion. Either he or a suitable person empowered by him can dictate the codes of religion. Real religion means to know God, our relationship with him, and our duties in relationship with him, and to know ultimately our destination after leaving this material body. The conditioned souls who are entrapped by the material energy hardly know all these principles of life. Most of them are like animals engaged in eating, sleeping, fearing, and mating. they are mostly engaged in sense enjoyment under the pretension of religiosity, knowledge, or salvation.
Yeah, see, once, so this is the nature of everybody in the material world. Right? Before coming to yes. Krishna consciousness, we all know. They are mostly engaged in sense enjoyment under the pretense of religiosity, knowledge, or salvation. We all went to temples, but you know the real purpose is, you know, passing the exam, getting some, you know, seat in the college or something. It's never related to pleasing the Lord. Did anybody went to temple to serve the Lord before you come in touch with Krishna consciousness? Anybody?
No, Prabhuji.
Just get our mind relaxed. That's it.
Yeah. It's all our gratification.
Our gratification.
People say, I come to temple and I'm so relaxed. Yes. It's about him again. Yes. It's never about God. It's never about pleasing the Lord. So that is the way we all live our life. Yeah. Go ahead, Prabhu.
They are still more blind in the present age of Kwadal or Kali Yuga. In the Kali Yuga, the population is just a royal addition of animals. They have nothing to do with the spiritual knowledge or godly religious life. They are so blind that they cannot see anything beyond the jurisdiction of the subtle mind, intelligence, or ego. But they are very much proud of their advancement in knowledge, science, and material prosperity.
Mm. You see, the first thing is, you know, they are like royal edition of animals, you know, because they do exactly the four principles of like animals. And they are so blind that they cannot see anything beyond the jurisdiction of mind, intelligence, and ego. And unfortunately, first of all, they are very fallen. On top of that, they are very much proud about their advancement in knowledge, science, and material prosperity. That's an unfortunate situation. That, you know, what is it called? In Bhagavad Gita, those people are described as Maya Aparihata.
Narathama.
Maya. Yeah, Narathama is a foolish guy. Yes. Maya Aparita Jnana means the knowledge has stolen. You know, they were covered by Maya. Right? They think they are great. Unfortunately, they are not. Right? Even many people in today's world, they think, you know, they are very advanced because, you know, they have better cars, they have better homes, better technology, right? They think, you know, people of the past, they didn't have these facilities and, you know, the knowledge. They're very proud. That is, you know, that is again another layer of illusion, actually. Can mute? Okay. Yeah, so that's an unfortunate situation in the material world, right? Yeah. Can you read this? These are very nice statements by Prabhupada.
Okay. He spoke the Bhagavad Gita specifically and eradicated all pretentious principles of religiosity. And prior to his departure from this material world, he empowered Sri Vyasadeva through Narada to compile the messages of the Srimad Bhagavatam. And thus both the Bhagavad Gita and the Srimad Bhagavatam are like torchbearers for the blind people of this age. In other words, if men in this age of Kali want to see the real light of life, they must take to these two books only, and their aim of life will be fulfilled. Bhagavad Gita is the preliminary study of the Bhagavatam, and Srimad Bhagavatam is the summum bonum of life, Lord Sri Krishna personified. We must therefore accept Srimad Bhagavatam as the direct representation of Lord Krishna. One who can see Srimad Bhagavatam can see also Lord Sri Krishna in person. They are identical.
So, qualities of Srimad Bhagavatam is described here. Srimad Bhagavatam is the summum bonum of life, Lord Krishna personified. It's as good as Lord Krishna himself directly. That is described here. Tatra kita yato vipra.
Tatra kita yato vipra.
Vipra she bhuri tejasa.
Vipra she bhuri tejasa.
Aham chadya gamam tatra.
Aham chadya gamam tatra.
Nivistas tad anugraha.
Nivistas tad anugraha.
Soham va. Sravayishyami.
Soham Sravayishyami.
Yatadhitam yathamati.
Yatadhitam yathamati.
How one should hear is given here. Nivishta. Nivishta means perfectly attentive. When we are hearing Srimad Bhagavatam, we should be 100% focused on that. No other business. Right? So that is the focus of mind one should have. Anugrahat. Another important quality to get the understanding of the relation is of Srimad Bhagavatam is the anugraha of the teacher. So one should have the blessing of the teacher who is giving the knowledge of Srimad Bhagavatam, anugraha. Right? So attention, when we are attentive, the teacher will be very merciful upon us. So with these two things, one get the realization of Srimad Bhagavatam. Yatha aditum, yatha mati. So this is described by Shukadeva Goswami. Let's read this. Go ahead.
O learned Brahmanas, when Shukadeva Goswami recited Bhagavatam there in the presence of Emperor Parikshit, I heard him with rapt attention and thus by his mercy, I learned the Bhagavatam from that great and powerful sage. Now I shall try to make you hear the very same thing as I learned it from him and as I have realized it.
So Suta Goswami is telling how he had, you know, in the assembly of, the sages in Naimisharanya, while the discussion is going between Emperor Parikshit and Sukadeva Goswami, he was attending. And, he was hearing this conversation with rapt attention. And because he was rapt in attention, he received the mercy of the speaker. By the mercy of the speaker, I learned Bhagavatam from the great and powerful sage. He's a great and powerful sage, fully renounced. Now I shall try to make you hear the very same thing as I learned it from him and I have realized it. Yathamati means, as per my realization, I'm going to speak, which I have learned when I heard with rapt attention and by the mercy of the speaker, Shukadeva Goswami. So this is the last verse of third chapter. We are finishing third chapter. So,
Prabhuji, one doubt, Prabhuji.
Mm-hmm.
Can I ask now?
Go ahead.
Yeah, basic doubt, like first Sukadeva Goswami talks to Parikshit Maharaj. Sukadeva Goswami listens in that and then he comes and tells that to sages of Naimisharanya, which is headed by Shaunaka Rishi, right?
Yeah.
So is Shaunaka Rishi also hearing from Sukadeva Goswami?
Yeah. Shaunaka Rishis were there in the assembly when Suta Goswami was speaking.
Suta Goswami.
He was not there in the previous assembly.
Correct. Okay. So sages of Naimisharanya plus Shaunaka Rishi are hearing to Suta Goswami.
Correct.
Okay.
Prabhuji, when Sukadeva Goswami reciting Bhagavatam to Parikshit Maharaj, one of the sages is there in that assembly, right? He is the one who is delivering this to Shaunaka Rishi in Naimisharanya, right?
Sutta Goswami, yeah, he's Sutta Goswami. Right?
Yeah, so that happened on the bank, Bank of Ganges, right? So there is a different assembly. But this here, now it is happening in Naimisharanya.
Naimisharanya.
The assembly of sages headed by Shaunaka Rishi, that is happening in Naimisharanya. And the speaker here is Sutta Goswami.
Sutta Goswami, yeah.
So, okay.
But Sutta Goswami, he was one of the listeners in the when Sukadeva Goswami is speaking, right?
Exactly, yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
He was a student there.
Yeah.
Speaker here.
Yeah.
Please read.
The word Nivishta means that Sukadeva Goswami drank the juice of Bhagavatam through his ears. That is a real process of receiving Bhagavatam. One should hear with rapt attention from the real person, and then he can at once realize the presence of Lord Krishna in every page. The secret of knowing Bhagavatam is mentioned here. No one can give rapt attention who is not pure in mind. No one can be pure in mind who is not pure in action. No one can be pure in action who is not pure in eating, sleeping, fearing, and mating. But somehow or other, if someone hears with rapt attention from the right person at the very beginning, one can assuredly see Lord Krishna in person in the pages of Bhagavatam.
Yeah. So here the sequence of required. So it's mentioned that the Suta Goswami heard with rapt attention. Right? So how is it possible that Suta Goswami was able to observe all the messages of Srimad Bhagavatam through his ears? Right? How he drank the juice of Bhagavatam through his ears? That is possible because the relation is given here. The secret of knowing Bhagavatam is mentioned here. No one can give rapt attention who is not pure in mind. So he could attentively hear Bhagavatam message because he was pure in mind. And how is purity of mind possible? Purity of mind is possible when one acts in his life in a pure way. Action should be pure. And how one's actions can be pure? It is possible when one's eating, sleeping, fearing, and mating is purified. Right? While living in this world, we have these four needs, basic needs. Ahara, nidra, bhaya, maithun. Right? So these four things are needed. If these activities are purified, if you eat prasadam, sleep regulatedly, and mate also regulatedly. So if you purify these activities, then your actions will be pure. When your actions are pure, you act in your life, you offer bhoga, you act everything with Krishna in mind, right? Then your mind is purified and you chant every day. And when your mind is purified gradually and slowly, then you can actually hear message of Bhagavatam with intention. Yeah, so that is how it works. So, but somehow or other, if someone hears with rapt attention from the right person at the very beginning, one can assuredly see Lord Krishna in person in the pages of Srimad Bhagavatam. So, just by studying Bhagavatam, one can get the darshan of the Supreme Lord. So, that is mentioned here. So that is the potency of Srimad Bhagavatam. Just by getting addicted to reading and hearing Srimad Bhagavatam, one gets to take the darshan of Lord Krishna himself directly. That is the promise of Bhagavatam itself directly. Yeah. So two important things mentioned here. One needs to take this message with rapt attention. One should hear with rapt attention. And one must receive the mercy of the speaker. So these two are very important to actually assimilate the message of Bhagavatam. One should never insult a speaker of Bhagavatam when he's speaking, especially in a Guru Parampara. One should be very careful. One should not displease intentionally or unintentionally. Yeah. So this ends third chapter. So third chapter, quickly what we covered is the first, it began with the Lord's Purusha Avatars, which are the incarnations of the material, for the material existence, the three Purusha Avatars. After the Purusha Avatars were described, the Leela, the other important incarnations, Leela, Guna, and Shakta Vesa, Manvantara Avataras were described, the 22 in total. Right? After describing all the Purusha Avataras and 22 other important incarnations, Lord Krishna's incarnation, or Lord Krishna was described as the source of all the incarnations. After that, so what about the middle existence? How can a materialistic person can see this was described? That is through Virat Purusha. And one should come out of that, you know, that understanding of the Supreme Lord, because that is, that's not the real form of the Lord. Virat Purusha is compared to the physical body of a human being. Just like physical body and subtle mind and, you know, subtle body is not the real self. So similarly, the Virat Purusha form of the Lord, which is the gigantic universal form of the Lord, even though it is the form of the Lord, one can conceive it as the form of the Lord because it's the energy and expansion of the Lord, but that is a temporary and that is not the real self. Just like the real self is, the soul is within the body, there is the transcendental form of the Lord that is to be approached. So that is given. And after that, describing the Virat form of the Lord, today's description was primarily the glorification of Srimad Bhagavatam, how Srimad Bhagavatam arisen after the departure of the Supreme Lord, and what are the qualities. The parampara was described, how it was originally given by Sukadeva Goswami to Parikshit Maharaj. You know, both were fully qualified. Parikshit Maharaj is the best person to hear. He was the emperor, but he has renounced everything. And Sukadeva Goswami was renunciate from the beginning of his birth. The next is Vyasadeva. Next is Sotu Goswami hearing from in the assembly, and now he is sharing with the sages of Naimisharanya. So the parampara was described, how it came to the middle world, and what is the position of Srimad Bhagavatam. This is the essence of all the scriptures. There is nothing but the best of all the historical incidents of the entire Vedic literature put together in this one scripture. So there is nothing more one should read beyond this Bhagavatam. This is the essence of everything. One should be qualified to hear this. One should receive the mercy of the speaker and hear with rapt attention. So this is all we heard in this chapter. Any questions? Is it very clear or very unclear?
Prabhu, the question is on the, like, when we say pure mind, and also we say that following the purity of the four principles. Now, in Kali Yuga, maybe when Sadhaka starts coming to the devotional platform, he may not be in that stage. So does that mean that he should not read a Bhagavatam, or he should will not understand it, or how?
No, one.
It's how a, you should approach.
It's a goal. It's a goal one should keep. One should ultimately hear with rapt attention. Even if you are online, while hearing Bhagavatam, don't try to accomplish your other tasks. For example, that's what it means. One should try to attentively hear.
Yes.
And by the mercy of the speaker, one gets the understanding of Bhagavatam. So this is what I remember Radhakrishna Prabhu focused on this. This sets the mood for hearing Srimad Bhagavatam. We should hear with rapt attention. Whenever we are coming to this session, this 1 hour, we understand Bhagavatam means you are dealing with Krishna directly. Because we heard, right, in these verses,
yes,
Bhagavatam is literally Lord Krishna himself. So one should give that attention to it. One should hear, by the mercy of whom, actually here in this case, it is Srila Prabhupada's mercy for us. Right? We are reading his purports, his explanations, his realizations here. Then we receive the mercy of Srila Prabhupada. Right? So then we get the understanding of Srimad Bhagavatam.
Right? Yes, Prabhu. But it's yours, like when we distribute the Bhagavatam and then somebody reads it, then what kind of mood other people should carry when they are not in the class, when we are just reading?
Correct. Yeah. So that is the reason. So that's the reason we attend the classes. We attend the classes so that we gather the inspiration to read and hear more, right? Yes. Now we read verse to verse. This is important, you know, reading through the relation of great acharyas. That's what we are doing here. This is the most important. Hearing the stories, pastimes, that's good, but that is only, that should act as an inspiration to come and read in detail. For example, Harivilash Maharaj always says, you know, what is the point of reading if you don't, you know, read in detail like this and go into purport and trying to understand the message, right? So without that, there is not much benefit. We can know the stories and, you know, we can appreciate it, but we don't receive that
the complete knowledge.
Complete knowledge without that mercy of Srila Prabhupada that we all aspire to get the understanding of Bhagavatam won't be available.
Thank you.
This detailed study is very important.
Yes, sir.
So we completed this chapter. I'm going to post this in our material. And we'll begin from fourth chapter. It will be the history. We'll begin history of Srimad Bhagavatam. Right? How Narada Muni inspired Vyasadev. The whole story, it's a more like story going forward in the next few chapters. And then there are, you know, basically the beginning is further inquiries by the sages of Naimisharanya into, you know, what was the history of Bhagavata? What was the history of, you know, the appearance of Parikshit Maharaj? So these questions will be discussed. So now kind of all the initial questions were answered in brief. Again, they were elaborated in, you know, later cantos. Now next set of questions will come in the next chapter and their answers will be discussed. The beautiful story of, beginning of Lord Krishna into Bhagavatam will come soon, very soon. He will enter as a chariot driver of Arjuna. That is his entrance into Bhagavatam. Okay, so we'll end here. If no other questions, we'll again come together next week. So everybody choose to be online again. Okay. Maybe I should have some snacks.
No, not like that. We'll come in person sometime.